Welcome to Insight. Today we are chatting with Joel Hoffman, Executive Director of the Vizcaya Museum and Gardens. Joel has generously agreed to share some of his experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Joel, for joining us today.
Thank you, Mark. Great to be here.
So the Vizcaya Museum and Gardens is really a jewel. It's been around for a very long time. Talk about the Vizcaya and talk about your plans currently to expand the audience experience of the Vizcaya Museum and Gardens.
Happy to do so. So Vizcaya was built as the winter residence of American businessman James Deering, who made his wealth in manufacturing farm equipment. His family's firm eventually became International Harvester. And he built Vizcaya really in the early 1910s and 20s, at a time that Miami was a pretty small city. He hired young architect, designer, landscape architect, not necessarily so conventionally experienced in a house of this scale. And after just a few winters of living at Vizcaya, he passed away. His family then spent the next decades trying to figure out how, in the 1950s, during the advent of modernism, a Mediterranean-styled large home with a lot of property on Bayfront Miami could become a public institution. And sort of amazingly, Miami-Dade County in the early 1950s recognized the opportunity, and Vizcaya has functioned as a public museum since 1953. For the first 50 years of Vizcaya's existence, like a lot of institutions that rise through governmental agencies, Vizcaya was operated under the county's Parks Department.
Right.
Our colleagues in the Parks Department did a great job, but in the 1990s, it was realized that Vizcaya was much more of a museum. The site was recognized as a National Historic Landmark, and so our governance was changed. We were treated as a separate entity within the county. And our own governing board was formed at that time. And I've been at Vizcaya for just about 13 years. It's been an incredible opportunity to learn about governance, different volunteer groups, how they all interact. And we are always working on perfecting that machine. A really big part of what my colleagues and I have been trying to do is sort of turn this large ship in a somewhat different direction and really reinvigorate it through new programs, give locals reasons to come back. And I think while it's really, it can be very tempting and comfortable and seductive to treat a place like Vizcaya as simply an easy visit, because we know so many people come and, you know, just have a look and fall in love with the place, we've really worked hard with our programming to introduce ideas that cause people to challenge their assumptions, think about the world hopefully in somewhat different ways, and not just leave thinking that they've seen only a beautiful place, but you know, they've seen a beautiful place and hopefully been stimulated to think about it in a somewhat different way.
How many people attend Vizcaya every year?
Our attendance has also doubled in the last decade. So we went from about 100,000 paid daytime visitation to about 200,000, and we've got about 50,000 other folks coming for educational programs, evening facility rentals, etc.
What is the composition of your audience, and has it changed?
So Vizcaya has for so many years been a really prime tourist attraction in Miami-Dade County, and this is a community that has long been associated with winter tourists, snowbirds who spend many months a year here. We've done very, very well with tourist markets and continue to do super well with tourist markets. I think there's a sense that when you come to Vizcaya, you are kind of discovering the original real Miami on some level, and you can see many of the roots of the history of our city in a visit to Vizcaya. But over the years, we have really focused on bringing our local community back to Vizcaya, trying to figure out how to encourage repeat visitation at a place that is sort of inherently static in terms of its exhibitions. And obviously programs have been a really important means for doing that. In the last decade, we've been working with contemporary artists like a number of historic sites have, and have really focused on site specificity. That's kind of been the hallmark of our program. Currently, relative to our efforts to build local audience, we've got an exhibition up called Lost Spaces. It looks at narratives and physical spaces at Vizcaya that no longer exist, sort of a celebration of the estate's centennial. And we have 11 different local artists who have interpreted different areas of the site. it's been really amazing to work with this group to see the interest that this program has engendered within our community. And even just at a recent reception, we had friends, family of all of these artists kind of coming together and seeing Vizcaya in ways that they never have.
Have you cordoned off and closed, or have you welcomed the public in to see the work being installed?
There's been very little closure, I would say. And we're open 6 days a week, so whether it's a capital project or an art installation, much of that tends to occur when the public is present. But these projects do tend to be relatively modest in scale. We've tried to find a balance between making a splash and a highly visible presence while also figuring out how our daytime visitor does not feel like they've just stumbled upon something so alien that they cannot really integrate it into their experience.
Are these installations exterior installations, interior installations, or a mixture of both?
In general, our interpretation of Vizcaya, which revolves around art history and the environment, has looked very closely at a complete integration of both the interior and the exterior. And that works extremely well because they were conceived, as a piece from a design and experiential perspective. So really with as many of our programs and our interpretation as possible, the house and the gardens are seen as a coexistent. And with the Contemporary Arts Program, we've got installations both in the house and scattered around the gardens. So a lot of our programs, it seems, really kind of encourage a physical exploration around the site, and that works rather well.
It's not like a museum where you're visiting specific galleries. You're actually experiencing the whole more.
We often grapple with whether Vizcaya is a museum, is it a public garden, is it a historic house. It's all of these things in one, and there's nothing like experiencing the site in person. I think we've really worked very hard to ensure that our visitors can experience the property on their own terms. We have managed to avoid a strictly dictated linear path through the property and have really embraced a lot of freedom of choice.
So people know Vizcaya. People here in the community know Vizcaya, visitors to the region know Vizcaya, but you also have another property right across the street that you are developing. Talk about what you're doing there.
We're incredibly fortunate. Across the street from Vizcaya's main house and gardens is a site with 11 historic buildings, a large parking lot, and a soon-to-be-vacated 1950s museum building known as the Vizcaya Village. The Vizcaya Village is where James Deering, Vizcaya's creator, housed his domestic farm animals. He actually had a very large-scale kitchen garden and a lot of back-of-house functions. And as I mentioned, in the 1950s, a science museum building was established on the site. That institution is moving to amazing new headquarters in downtown Miami. And so we have the opportunity in the coming years to really rethink and revitalize that whole village property and reunify the two sides of the site. Although Vizcaya comes across as a very open and expansive property, we are so sorely lacking in programmatic space, back of house space. We have really no classrooms in the main house and garden, so our efforts to engage with school groups in deeper and more meaningful ways are really limited by that. We really see the village as an incredible opportunity to just dramatically expand all our educational programming and introduce a whole element of urban agriculture to the site, which also links back nicely to its founder's history in farm equipment.
It will really transform the Vizcaya experience, and it will enrich it, particularly with the classrooms, the new facilities that are there. You basically finesse the contradiction of having what seems like a very expansive space, but then in practical terms, it's very difficult to utilize some of the way that space is configured for these purposes. But now you have this new potential.
Absolutely, and we're also incredibly hampered in the story that we can tell. All historic sites at this point in time are not being responsible stewards if they are not telling sort of the full spectrum of social history that occurred at the site. It is very difficult to do that with the main house and the very few back of house spaces that we've got in the main house. The village provides just this spectacular contradiction to the main house and gardens in so many ways.
So you'll be out there capital fundraising.
We will. We're still working on revitalizing aspects of the main house and gardens, but the village is really the future, and that's going to be our goal in the coming years.
Wonderful. Joel Hoffman, thank you so much for sharing the work of Vizcaya. We wish you well on the Village project, and thank you so much for your insights.
Thank you, Mark. Really a pleasure.